All right, joining us on Hot Copy this morning, we have Attorney Vic Rodriguez, spokesperson for presumptive president, Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. Attorney Vic Rodriguez, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen. Good morning to all your viewers, and thank you for inviting me again in your program.
All right, let's talk about the transition team. You did announce yesterday that you are forming already a transition team. Can you give us a little more detail, Attorney Vic, who's in charge? What are the concerns of the team right now?
The transition team essentially will still be composed of our executive committee, those people that are behind our successful campaign we have just concluded and that resulted in a resounding win for President-elect Bongbong. And we still have to reach out to the transition team of the present dispensation. And maybe within that day, I'll be making a call to the Executive Secretary Miguel Dea, who is partly the head of the Malacanang transition team.
Now, of course, presidents have different styles. I wanted to ask you, there's an assumption that some of the members of the transition team will actually be the permanent appointments or permanent members of the cabinet of President-elect Marcos. Would that be the case?
Well, certainly some members of our transition team would form part of his official cabinet. And these are the same people that we have worked with and I think enjoys that level of trust and confidence, as well as have shown their that degree of competence for them to be qualified for whatever portfolio that President-elect Bongbong will assign them.
Okay. Now, yesterday, Mr. Marcos spoke, and he actually, it was quite interesting in that press briefing, because he did give us an idea of the process. He said, I'm talking to experts in each department. And immediately he said that political leanings of an expert is not important to him, whether kung lumaban ba o sumama sa kanya. Can you take us through the process? How are you choosing experts? How is Mr. Marcos contacting experts? What are you doing in each field?
Yeah, well, now it can be told, Karen, even during the campaign, he wants to be a brief on matters that are important for the people to be hearing. That's why even during the campaign, he consults with people who are very knowledgeable on economy, people who are very knowledgeable about the power and power supply, power generation. He, of course, he's very knowledgeable himself on agriculture, but still, he consulted many people who are experts in agriculture, and it's not unusual for him to be carrying that good practices into the vetting and selection process for the people that would comprise his would-be administration and his cabinet.
So would that mean, Attorney Rodriguez, that, for example, we might be seeing technocrats or experts coming from the Arab administration or even Pinoy's administration or even Cory's? Would it look like that?
Absolutely. Basta before I joined your program, Karen, I was in another program. And the basic, the baseline essentially is you must recognize and owe allegiance to the country. Kinakailangan mahal mo ang bansang Pilipinas. Kinakailangan kinikilala mo ang watawat ng Republika ng Pilipinas. Kinakailangan rinirespeto mo ang saligang batas at hindi ka nanawagan o nananawagan ng papagbabagsak ng gobyerno. Yun ang kinakailangan natin. Yung may pagmamahal sa Pilipinas, yung may paggalang sa Pilipino, at yung handang magsakripisyo. Of course, the other equally important qualification, I suppose, is yung competence and integrity in the field that you are an expert or known in the industry.
Okay. And yesterday, Mr. Marcos also talked about critical areas of his concern. He mentioned the economy, the price of energy, prices, lack of jobs, infrastructure. Where are you now in terms of, you know, it's also to address investor anxiety. Where is the team now in terms of coming up with the first 100 days, I guess, laying it out there? So you do have a calmer business community at this point.
We just officially sat as an Execom transition team yesterday, and we ended up just before he made his announcement again and talked to the nation, addressing the nation rather. And of course, the economy is very important. That's why we're mindful that his term will commence noon of June 30. We still have time to really go through a tedious vetting process, and especially his would-be economic team and economic managers. Unemployment is still our enemy. Hindi ho ang tayong mga Pilipino ang dapat nag-aaway-away. Ang kalaban natin ay ang unemployment, kakulangan ng opportunity, underemployment. Ang daming hanap buhay, Karen, alam mo yan, na nagsara at nabangkarote. Ito yung tunay na nakaaway. That's why we will still continue as we go along in informing his official cabinet. We will still continue, going back to your earlier question, to reach out regardless of political color, race, or belief. Basta tanda kang magsirbisyo at magsakripisyo at higit sa lahat, rinerespeto mo ang ating watawat, you, he, or she may be considered. And for as long as you are qualified and competent, we look beyond politics, we look beyond political color. While we have mentioned it many times that while we were under strict instruction and guidance from President-elect Bongbong not to look beyond May 9, and here comes the wisdom behind it, May 11, when he presided over the meeting, the reason why he said don't look beyond May 9, because May 11, he is able to look beyond politics. Wala nang politika, tapos na yan, matasyadong mataas yung expectation ng 31 million Filipinos, and we have to deliver. And he said it clearly last night, we will hit the ground running.
Okay. Now, what's interesting last night, a few questions there, is Mr. Marcos said every day he will be announcing, he'll be talking to the press every day. Although that first one, he didn't take questions from the press, but he said he wants to keep everyone informed on what's going on, his plans, what the team is doing. So, ang tanong ng marami, Attorney Vic, it's actually the first time many have heard Mr. Marcos speak this way, act this way. Bakit di niya ito ginawa, sir, nung kampanya?
We've been doing that, Karen. As I have mentioned to you many, many, many times in your program, our preferred mode of communication is direct to the people.
Social media, to the people.
And we've been, he's the candidate who's been out 5 times a week, and we've been holding rallies, mini town halls, 3 times a day, and that was our preferred mode of communication. So I think it is inaccurate for one to say that he's not been talking and dealing with the people. It's okay. It's just that our preferred mode is go directly to the people.
Okay, Attorney Vic, I've seen photos the victory. I wouldn't say victory party, but photos that have come out all over social media. And people were celebrating around Mr. Marcos. But you know him quite well. I mean, he looked almost like in disbelief and in shock. His face was quite serious while everyone around him was in revelry. What, take us that night. What was he sensing, feeling? What was it like?
The tension was all over during the conduct of the election, and all the way during the initial transmission of the returns coming from the precinct level, Karen. And he was there to monitor. And sure, friends are there to, you know, see that the numbers are getting higher and the margin is getting larger. But when he went back to the headquarters, that is where we sat down and assessed the situation. And when we made the announcement last May 9, I think around 10:30 in the evening, I just told him that based on the the returns transmitted, it's around 74.30 something the time. And of course, we have to do a complete check, like a complete staff work and due diligence. We crunch on the numbers, and it's just his way. He said, my gratitude can no longer wait. I have to thank the millions of those who have voted for me and Merinday without first claiming that I have won the election. Oh. That's why, if you have noticed,
did you or even Mr. Marcos frankly expect 31 million votes?
We were hoping.
Is this a shock to him?
We were hoping to win, Karen, but we were also made aware that there is a strong voter turnout early in the day, around 8 or 9. We've been receiving reports, talagang andaming tao. And to our assessment, na pag mas maraming tao, mas pabor sa kanya. Because the challenge really was for us, how to bring those throngs of people who attended this rally, na paano may convert yan? We have to make sure that they go out, they might fall into a wrong sense of complacency, let's not vote, he's already a winner, etc. So when we were monitoring that there seems to be a strong turnout of voters, we knew that is going to favor him. Did we expect 31 million? Honestly, no. Are we happy? Absolutely, we are happy with the 31 million.
I'm just curious offhand, what number were you expecting? I mean, every team would have some expectation, especially coming from President Duterte, who was 16 million. What were the ballpark figures?
When we were starting, Karen, our base really on the assumption of what was based on the numbers last 2016, his count will not begin from zero. His count will begin from 14 million something. So and using the 2016 scenario where we saw a great votes for President Duterte, we projected we need at least 20 million to win convincingly. And those were the numbers that we're looking at until the campaign officially opened and we went into it. Mga middle ng campaign, Karen, nung nararamdaman namin yung reception ng tao, we felt we can push it up to 25 million.
25.
But when we're looking now at the surveys, parang higit pa sa 25 eh. So we just have to wait. And after the end of the campaign, we assessed last May 8. We did our due diligence. We did everything humanly possible. What to do is we just have to wait for the outcome of the elections.
All right. Now, moving forward, I mean, I was just very curious about that particular night. Mr. Marcos said he's talking to experts. He wants the experts on each field. And I want to ask about the first appointment. Without taking anything away from Vice President-elect Sara Duterte, you do have people questioning, would she be the best and most qualified person to be DepEd Secretary, considering it's not particularly, some say, her field of expertise? The Alliance of Concerned Teachers have already spoken and said the only recommendation they've heard from her in the past few years is, frankly, to mandate ROTC. So how did this happen? Did he choose her for that post? Did she request for that post?
Number one, Karen, we respect the opinion of the Alliance of Concerned Teachers. Is she qualified? Definitely, she's a lawyer. And the biggest qualification, I think it's indisputable, she has the confidence of the 31 million Filipinos who voted her into office. That's the biggest qualification. And she enjoys the trust and confidence of the appointing power in President-elect Bongbong. I think that's the most important. Now, as to her competence, let's give her a chance to prove that she's able to, that she can run ably the Department of Education.
Okay. And I mean, I wanted to pursue that because coming from that, in 2018, the Philippines is the lowest among 58 countries in math and science. So you do have now educators actually asking if Ms. Duterte is the right person to take students forward into a more competitive level.
That was 2018, Karen. And it's not the fault of Vice President-elect Inday Sara Duterte if we are lagging behind in those fields of education. And that is why the person that President-elect Bongbong have chosen in the person of Vice President-elect Inday, let's give her a chance. And for the qualification, again, I refer back to the figures that are being shown in the transparency server where we are all been, which we have all been using. She has the full trust and backing of 31 million Filipinos. And if we have been lagging behind in those subject matters, it's not because of Vice President-elect Inday Sara Duterte.
Oh, yeah, definitely it's not because of that. But I guess the question is, since Mr. Marcos himself said he's speaking with experts on each field, I think the question is, do they believe or does he believe she's the best person for the job?
He believes that Mayor Vice President-elect Inday Sara Duterte can lead the Department of Education well, and she believes that she is up to the challenge.
Okay, moving forward, the finance secretary, there are already talks that Mr. Walter Wasmer, formerly of BDO, could be the next finance secretary. Of course, the economic team is very important. You have investor anxiety asking, who's the next economic team? Who's in the economic team? What about these talks on Mr. Walter Wasmer?
I am not at liberty to reveal other names yet until we have spoken to those names that President-elect Bongbong will be mentioning. To be fair, not just to President-elect Bongbong, but to the people who are in private sector. And of course, to the economy. It's a very delicate subject matter. And we have to be very careful because it's no longer just campaigning to win, but it's now the economic fundamentals and the economic future of the country that is on the table.
Yeah. Here's a good question for you. Will Mr. Marcos retain old secretaries of President Duterte, old faces, or is he the kind of president that he wants fresh faces, his own people?
We have not spoken about that lengthily on the extent of the appointments, considering that we only met yesterday, Karen, late in the afternoon. Uh-oh. But if there are good people out there, that not necessarily probably in the same position, but if they can still render service in some other capacity, absolutely he will consider.
What is Mr. Marcos like in terms of leadership? I'm curious, Attorney Vic. You know, when someone wins, the lobbying can get very intense. You'll have certain groups saying, oh, tao ko naman ilagay mo dito, tao ko lagay mo dito. I want this post. Take us inside Mr. Marcos's behavior. What's he like when he makes decisions?
Sinabi naman niya na may mga political appointees naman talaga. Hindi may tatanggi yan. Mm-hmm. But of course, for the key positions, especially on the economy, he would want to really have the best person out there available and who is willing to sacrifice. And several names have been floated, but the challenge really, Karen, is how would you convince them to leave their private life na doon nga, wala namang nagbabantay sa yung media, walang bumabati ko sa yon, taas-taas ng sahod mo, baka yung isang taon mo sa gobyerno, anim na taon mo sa gobyerno, isang araw, isang transaction mo lang sa privado. So these are the challenges that he is facing, but I think to balance that out, I think the most the what makes it inviting for these people to even consider joining the government is the 31 million mandate that President-elect Bongbong and Vice President-elect Inday received from the Filipino people last Monday. And as I have said, I think also in your program, a lot of people, especially on the business and the investors, are looking at the sudden shift in the vote preference of us Filipinos. We were used to see or rather we are used to being ticket splitters, Karen. Yeah, iba yung presidente mo, iba yung vice president mo. But I think the message really and his call for unity have resonated. Na nakita ng tao, nag-trace back ilang administration na magkaaway yung presidente at vice president. Walang trabaho yung vice presidente. Inaaway ng vice presidente yung pangulo. Ngayon nakita nila, parehong grupo, united, tandem, at kahapon nga nag-announce that marami kami natanggap na magagandang messages na at least now makakakita tayo ng working vice president. And it's not a token position, Karen, as you know. Magtatrabaho ito. So I think these are the reasons na maaari pa kami makapag-imbita ng mga magagaling at qualified and competent sa incoming Bongbong Marcos presidency.
Okay, Attorney Vic, what about nepotism? I mean, at one point during the campaign, Mr. Marcos did say that as long as a relative was qualified or something to that degree, is he keeping that same policy? Because, I mean, the law's quite clear when it comes to that. But what do you advise him? Where will you end up? Not you personally, but in terms of hiring, getting relatives to work with him and appointing them in key positions.
We will respect the prohibitions provided for in the Constitution and probably even in the, under the civil service law. Kung hindi kong qualified naman at wala namang prohibition sa ilalim ng ating batas, hindi naman siguro tama na qualified at magaling yung tao handang magserbisyo dahil lang kamag-anak mo na malayo eh disqualified na. Hindi malulugi yung appointing power. Ang malulugi yung sambayan ng Pilipino. Eh kung magaling talaga, hindi mo mai-appoint dahil nga lang mai-issuehan ka, mai-intriga ka. For as long as he will not be violating any law, for as long as the person, a distant relative or a relative is qualified and competent, I don't see any reason why he or she should not be given a position. Kawawa naman yung serbisyo makukuha sana natin kung magaling naman talaga.
Oh, okay, let's go back to the economy a bit, then we go to foreign affairs. Let's talk about the JP Morgan report recently. I know you would want to discuss this as well. It dropped the Philippines to the bottom of the ASEAN investment preference list. And you do have some analysts saying that it has nothing to do with Mr. Marcos, but you have some saying it's because Mr. Marcos won. So let's talk about the JP Morgan report, attorney.
Let's be very careful, Karen, because it's the economy. The JP Morgan, I think it was taken out of context purposely or otherwise, but they were not referring to President-elect or the ascendancy of President-elect Bongbong Marcos. They were not. And other statements made by so-called economists, I think it should be taken in the context that it was made more of or as a political statement than from a standpoint of an economic manager or economic managers. Hanggang doon lang ang aking sasagutin sapagkat that is all about the economy.
Okay. And to be fair, I'm going to read a part of the report just so there's balance for our viewers. The JP Morgan report did say that it's the macroeconomic policies and they flagged rising risks from high public debt and surging inflation, which of course comes from the previous administration. Mm-hmm. But they did point out certain concerns future-wise of Mr. Marcos's lack of substantive economic platform and the absence of what they call a meaningful track record. How would you respond to that, attorney? Do you think...
I have said these are more political, Karen. Okay. Having the statement that you have just read, for me, it sounded more political than all economic. About the economy. Yeah, it's so political.
Mm. Okay. All right. So moving forward, I mean, we're presuming Mr. Marcos will be addressing the economy anyway in the days to come. As he said, he will do it every day. Now, Fitch Solutions, on the other hand, says there will be continuity. There will be a soft transition of power. So there's another question. Will Mr. Marcos be another Duterte?
What do you mean by that?
In other words, is it absolute continuity from President Duterte's leadership? Because you do have also some sectors, and I mean, that are quite concerned about also how Mr. Duterte treated business, treated several, example, human rights issues. So when it talks about continuity, a smooth transition of power is another thing, but how would you describe Mr. Marcos's leadership? Is it a Duterte 2.0? Or how would you describe it? Is it change?
Karen,
what is it?
Karen, last May 9, 2022, last Monday, the Filipino people, 31 million of us, voted for Bongbong Marcos. So he will have his own government, he will have his own governance, and he is his own man. Anything away from PRRD, yeah. But uh-huh. President-elect Bongbong will continue lahat ng magagandang programa ni Pangulong Duterte, specifically the build. In fact, he's been very, very vocal about this to include the digital infrastructure in the blueprint of the build. So, as I have said again, the people voted for Bongbong Marcos last Monday. He will have his own government. He will have his own governance, and he is his own man.
Okay. Will we be hearing from Mr. Marcos in the coming days on controversial issues in terms of policy, like, for example, isabong? Or do you believe he'll wait this out until he actually sits as president?
Well, he has his thoughts on the isabong, and he is also mindful of its social cost. So, yan, pag-uusapan yan, how to balance yung the need of the government for revenue, especially now he will be faced with 13 trillion debt. But at the same time, old school talaga itong si President-elect Bongbong. He values family. So he's also looking at the downside of it, which is in social cost. At may mga report na may mga bata na wala ng control, nagsusugal na rin.
Which is true. Which is true.
I know. So yan, binabantayan niya yan. Sa kanya, at the end of the day, hindi yung revenue pwede mong i-let go kung magsasakripisyo naman yung ating basic political unit, which is the family.
Okay, let's talk about foreign affairs. The United States already issued a statement that they're ready to work with Mr. Marcos, and they want to continue the special partnership with the Philippines. And in fact, they even said that the elections were conducted, the words they used, according to international standards. We've seen the pivot in terms of foreign relations from Pinoy's time to the extreme pivot during PRRD's time. Where will the Philippines be with Mr. Marcos?
What I can tell you, Karen, you can expect and look forward to a better relationship with our longtime partner and ally, the United States. And the foreign policy of President-elect Bongbong, it will be inclusive. We will not be exclusive to anyone. The interests of the Filipino people and the national interest comes first, and they will never be compromised, and especially on our territorial integrity. It will never be compromised. But as far as our relationship with the United States under the administration of President-elect Bongbong, I assure you now that it will get better.
Okay. All right. That's quite an assurance coming from you. That's foreign policy already, what you just said. And I wanted to ask you this because it's quite interesting. The reporters did note that you avoided this question during the press conference, but they did say that the relationship with the U.S. is complicated by the contempt order issued by a U.S. district court. Will this be a condition that Mr. Marcos will ask for, that the U.S. deal with that particular contempt order?
Number one, Karen, I am not to claim expertise on that subject matter. Okay. That was handled by a different lawyer. But the question given yesterday is more of it was more of an update. Me coming out was more of an update on what's going on. And again, that's it would affect, it will cut across our relationship with the United States. That's why we are very, very careful. But like what I have assured you just a moment ago, I assure you, Karen, and the Filipino people, that our relationship with the United States will be better. And as we speak, I think I am at liberty to say we are expecting a call from the President of the United States to President-elect Bongbong.
Today? So yes. President Joe Biden will be calling today?
Yes, we are expecting his call.
All right. Well, I do hope that you update us regarding that call. And with China, I've read that Mr. Marcos wants a a different kind of agreement with China or cooperation. What does that mean, sir?
Sorry?
Yeah. I've also read that Mr. Marcos would want a different kind of cooperation or relationship with China. Can you expound on that?
It's a continuing process, not just with the US and China. It's also in our constitution, enshrined in our constitution, that we have to peace and amity with all other nations as part of the international community. So not specifically with China. We will continue to enhance whatever relationship we have with our neighbors and with other foreign countries. We will continue to enhance and try to look for a better working arrangement that will benefit the country and the Filipino people, especially if we have Filipinos staying there, whether as a resident or as workers. So importante na mapangalagaan natin yung interest pa rin at kapakanan ng ating mga kababayan, and we will continue. It's a work in progress. You have to be up to it every day.
Do you already have, does Mr. Marcos already have a foreign affairs secretary in mind?
Meron na, Karen, pero again, I am not yet at liberty because we still have to be talking to these people that he has in mind. But until that happens and until he or she would accept whatever position that President-elect Bongbong will offer him or her, then I think I am not in a position to reveal anything as of yet.
Okay. All right. Now, another question is, you do have protests outside of COMELEC, supporters of Vice President Lenny Robredo. Among the other candidates, it's Vice President Lenny Robredo and Senator Kiko Pangilinan who have not formally, officially conceded, so to speak, although VP Robredo did say that the numbers are getting clearer. Let's accept, how the choice or the will of the people. If I remember correctly, she said it in Filipino. But what do you make, would it make a difference? Would Mr. Marcos, would you want her to already concede? I mean, because you do have her supporters that are very riled up, still asking for justice, accountability with the COMELEC at this point.
Well, alam mo yung pagko-concede, Karen, hindi ini-impose yan, hindi hinihingi yan. Yan ay kusang ibinibigay nung taong gustong mag-concede. So whether she concede or not, the numbers are there. We're looking at the same transparency servers. It's 31 million Filipinos, more or less. And for those who are protesting, please, stop pushing for your agenda of hostility among Filipinos. Hindi tayong magkakaaway. Huwag po ninyong pag-away-away ng Pilipino. Uulitin ko, nasa gitna pa tayo ng pandemya. Sumailalim si President-elect Bongbong at si Vice President-elect Inday Sara Duterte sa kaparehas na demokratikong prosesong pinagdaanan ng napili ninyong kandidato. Nangampanya kami. Ang kampanyahan, tinapos namin, 90 days din naman kami ng kampanya, hindi 95, pare-pareho lang tayong binigyan ng 90 days. Dumaan sa pinaka-demokratikong proseso si President-elect Bongbong at Vice President-elect Inday noong Lunes, kagaya ng napili ninyong kandidato. Ngayong nagsalita na, ang higit sa mayorya ng Pilipino, 31 million Filipinos have spoken, respetuhin po natin ang naging pahayag at naging pili o napili ng higit sa mayorya ng ating sambayanan. Respetuhin po natin ang ating watawat, respetuhin at kilalanin po natin ang saligang batas.
Okay, my last question is, what I'm curious, are you seeing the possibility ever of Mr. Marcos reaching out to Vice President Lenny Robredo or even holding a dialogue of some sort? Is that something you can see, Attorney Vic?
Willing kaming kausapin at makipag-usap sa lahat ng tao regardless of their political color, race, or belief. Sinabi na yan ni President-elect Bongbong, sasabihin ko ulit, while we were under express guidance from him not to look beyond May 9, yesterday was totally different.
Yeah.
The instruction was, look beyond politics. Wala akong pakialam kung nakalaban natin. Yeah, wala akong pakialam kung nakalaban natin o kinalaban tayo, nagsalita o nakapagsalita ng masakit. Subalit kung handang maglingkod at importante, may respeto sa saligang batas, kinikilala yung ating watawat at hindi nananawagan ng pagpababagsak ng gobyerno, maaaring ikonsidera at ituloy natin yung ating panawagan ng pagkakaisa.
Attorney, huli na lang ito talaga. Ito, there are threats of an academic walkout, no classes under a Marcos administration. You have student governments of UP, Ateneo, La Salle, FEU Polytechnic University, all resisting the mandate given to Mr. Marcos. How would he? What are your thoughts on that? And what kind of action would Mr. Marcos take?
Hayaan lang namin sila. Karapatan nilang magprotesta, Karen, pero maawa naman kayo sa inyong mga magulang na nagsusumikap araw-araw, nagtatrabaho, nagpupuyat. Yung iba mo siguro sa magulang ng mga batang yan ay nag-migrate pa, nagtrabaho, overseas Filipino workers. Hindi po ninyo, you're not doing justice to the hard work and effort of your parents. Nagrarally kayo para ano? Para ano, you're resisting what? Marcos Duterte, binoto ho sila ng taong bayan. Kagaya ninyo, kung bumoto man kayo, bumoto rin yung 31 million Filipinos. Why can't you just respect that? Inaanyayahan ko pa rin kayo, sumali po kayo at we will continue to reach out and extend our hands of unity. At pagbigyan ninyo, na makita naman ninyo kung anong klaseng gobyerno may magkakaroon tayo sa ilalim ng Marcos Duterte. At tapos na ho yung eleksyon, isang araw lang yan. At tatandaan ninyo, nagsalita na yung higit sa mayorya ng ating mga Pilipino. Ang napili nila ay si President-elect Bongbong at Vice President-elect Inday Sara. Respetuhin natin yan. At iisa lang ho ang bansa natin. Iisa lang lahi natin, lahing Pilipino, bansang Pilipinas, at isa lang ang ating collective future. Sumali po kayo dito sa aming panawagan ng pagkakaisa. And when you see that when the time comes at official na naupo si President-elect Bongbong at nakita ninyo na may mga dapat kundinahin, that's the time you go out, you do your protest. But I think it is not fair for everyone, for the great majority of the Filipino people, for this very, very small segment of the society to be disrupting our daily lives.
On that note, Attorney Vic Rodriguez, thank you for joining me on Headstart this morning. So we'll wait for news on the update today, especially with U.S. President Biden calling President-elect Marcos within the day. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Karen. Magandang umaga at mabuhay po ang bansang Pilipinas.